Well, good morning, and welcome to our memorial service for Bill Gregory. We are so glad that you could be here with us to celebrate his wonderful life. We have a great service filled with memories, prayers, song, and presentations. If you could please rise as you are able to start off our service with our gathering song. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy, the God of all consolation, who comforts us in all our sorrows so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the consolation we ourselves have received from God. All who are baptized into Christ have put on Christ. In his baptism, Bill was clothed with Christ. In the day of Christ's coming, he shall be clothed with glory. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, who formed us from the dust of the earth, who by your breath gave us life, we glorify you. We glorify you. Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life, who suffered death for all humanity, who rose from the grave to open the way to eternal life, we praise you. We praise you. Holy Spirit, author and giver of life, the comforter of all who sorrow, our sure confidence and everlasting hope, we worship you. We worship you. To you, Blessed Trinity, be the glory and honor forever and ever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
If you would be seated, please. Let us pray together. Almighty God, source of all mercy and giver of comfort, graciously tend to those who mourn, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Our sympathy goes out to the family of Bill, at their sorrow and their loss. And we, the people of St. Paul's, we feel that same sorrow and loss. Yet we are joyful with Bill's destination. I saw John Meyer this week. You may remember John. He was a member here for a very long time, who left a couple years ago to worship with his family up in Kenosha area. And I said, you know, John, Bill's memorial is on Saturday. And he was like, oh. He says, Sue and I have plans that we just can't get out of. He says, but would you extend our sympathy to the family? I said, I certainly will. So John and I began to talk about all the time that he worked here with Bill. And he told me one funny story. And we just had some fond remembrances, which made me think everyone has memories of Bill. Can you see him pulling into the parking lot in his little yellow PT Cruiser? And he and Marty getting out and coming in? You know, they joke about Lutherans that always, you know, sit in the same place in church. Well, it's no different in a parking lot. Bill had that spot. And everybody knew it was Bill's spot. And nobody parked there, I think, out of respect. And it's the same thing here in church. I think he was right here with Marty, right up in front here. I can see him sitting there, quiet during the service. I can see him in Fellowship Hall. I bet you can too. See the smile on his face, or hear his laugh, or his conversation. Can you see him in Fellowship Hall contemplating a piece of apple pie with a fork in his hand? He did much more than contemplate that piece of apple pie. He enjoyed it. Everyone has their memories of Bill. And Bill never ceased to amaze. One day after a service, Grace Bricka was downstairs and she was talking with me. And she said that she and Andy and her girls had been up in Wisconsin the day before and they found an injured bird. And she showed me a picture on her phone and she said, we think it's a peregrine falcon. And Bill's like, peregrine falcon? She says, let me see that. And so Bill takes a look at the phone. He goes, that's a peregrine falcon, all right. And everybody's like, so, Bill, how do you know that? And Bill says, well, Marty and I are members of the Peregrine Falcon Society in Chicago. And then he goes and proceeds to tell us how the Peregrine Falcons love the tall buildings, how they nest up there, and how they would make habitats for them up there and photograph them and their hatchlings. And you just kind of shake your head like, wow. But he always had something interesting to say. Well, we talked about his employment with Illinois Bell. And he talked about how he was on loan from another department and he did photographs and they went into slide presentations. This is before, you know, what we have now. And I said, well, wow. I said, you know, I know a guy who worked at one television center. And he put the audio with those slide presentations. And Bill kind of remembered him, but, you know, the stories corroborated so well, just the different things that he had to say. And yes, Bill, a photographer. I would speculate that there isn't a photograph in the last how many years that were either taken by one of two men, Bob Osmond or, yes, Bill Gregory. The last pictorial director that was done some years ago, Bill Gregory, sitting up in the choir room with the backdrop and taking everyone's photos. Christmas pageants, confirmations, you name it. I would bet that St. Mark's has got the most extensive photographic history in the whole ELCA. It's just amazing. When we built the educational wing, Bill was here nearly every day documenting and photographs the progress of the construction. It was a love, it was a passion, it was a profession, it was a gift that he had, and it was a gift to us all. To kind of let the funny things that happened. The tech team was meeting one day, and he had his camera with him. No surprise. And we're just talking. And he said, I had my camera cleaned. $350. Everybody was like, $350 to clean a camera? And Bill just said very matter-of-factly, well, it is a $6,000 camera. Everybody's like, who knew, I think at $350, that's the price of a camera. Not the cost of cleaning one. So Bill had a great gift and love. I had a section here that I have to omit that had to do with something that was near and dear to my heart, and certainly near and dear to, I'm going to look over this direction, to your hearts. But Gene Norcus is, I'm told, going to cover the Scout Oath and the Scout Law. I'll just say that they definitely describe Bill. There's a lot of other stories I could tell, and I know there's many stories that you would have, remembrances of Bill. We were talking one day, and he said to me, he says, well, I grew up in Chicago, and my dad had a restaurant. And then he's talking about other things. He says, I've known Marty since we were kids. And at one point he says, my brother was dating Marty. He says, but I married her. And when you talk about Bill, you can't not talk about Bill and Marty, because they were pretty inseparable. So let me just close with this. I want you to just kind of picture this. Bill dies. And suddenly he finds himself at the gate of heaven. And there's St. Peter, and who else? And of course, St. Peter says, Bill, it's good to see you. And Bill says, it's good to be seen. Right? Is it? St. Peter says, Bill, Marty's waiting inside for you. Go on in. And Bill kind of disappears into the gate of heaven. And we hear Bill's voice. Marty, I'm home. Thank you.
Carol and family members, I just want to say, first thing, our scouting family, we are so heartily sorry for the loss of, who we know as Bill Gregory. Will the scouts please rise for the Scout Oath? On my honor, I will do my best to do my duty to God and my country, and to obey the Scout Law, and to help other people at all times, keep myself physically strong, mentally awake, and morally straight. The Scout Law. A Scout is trustworthy, loyal, helpful, friendly, courteous, kind, obedient, cheerful, thrifty, brave, clean, and reverent. Thank you. This morning when I printed this off, I just looked at all the 12 points of the Scout Law, and all I kept thinking about was Bill Gregory. All the things that, friendly, number one, anyone who walked in this church, Bill was one of the first people that would come up and greet you and make you feel welcome. And it was like a beeline with Bill, especially if he knew you were new, boy, he was right at that door. Cheerful. Bill was, you never saw him with a cross look on his face, never. clean. Every time we had a scout function, he was always there to help. Any camp out, you know, the old saying for scouts, leave no trace, make sure it looks better than the way it was when you first, when you first got there. Trustworthy. You could tell Bill a secret and it wouldn't go any further than what, you know, it wouldn't go past any, you know, he wouldn't tell anyone. Loyal. He was such a loyal friend. Wonderful to the church. Another thing that makes me think of Bill, like Paul said, with photography. Everything that council had, like this weekend, I'll mention one thing. This weekend is Fall Conclave. I can remember every year when we had Fall Conclave, there was Bill with his camera taking pictures of everyone. And then everything, you know, with our church, with scouting, Bill was always there. For me, my biggest thing with Bill that I look at is reverent. Bill would always come to our church meetings, you know, our scout meetings every Thursday or when we had functions, and he always made like a beeline towards Jeannie. And he'd always go, okay, Jeannie, you're here every Thursday. And, you know, other times also as well, and he'd go, when are you going to join the church? And this was all the time. Every time I saw him walking towards me, I knew what he was going to say. And finally, 5 years later, and I'm talking 5 years, he did this. He worked on me for 5 years. I finally joined St. Mark's Lutheran Church. And because of Bill, if it wasn't for him, this would not be my second home right now. And because of that, I love him very much. And he will be missed by our scouting family. And I thank you.
The first reading is from the book of 1 Kings, chapter 19, verses 11 through 13. He said, go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. Now there was a great wind, so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks in pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, what are you doing here, Elijah? The second reading is from the book of Psalm, chapter 85, verses 8 through 13. Let me hear what God the Lord will speak, for he will speak peace to his people, to his faithful, to those who turn to him in their hearts. Surely his salvation is at hand for those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land. Steadfast love and faithfulness will meet. Righteousness and peace will kiss each other. Faithfulness will spring up from the ground, and righteousness will look down from the sky. The Lord will give what is good, and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness will go before him and will make a path for his steps.
Thank you, Jill, for reading. Thank you, Jeannie and Paul, for those beautiful stories. So, not in the earthquake, not in the wind or the fire, but God speaking in sheer silence. Is it about the silence that gives space for God to speak? Bill was a nature photographer and, in a way, had tuned himself to notice beauty and take solace in the great outdoors, in the quietness. In our scripture passage this morning, Elijah is on the run. Life has gotten overwhelming, and he is tired. He's out of gas. And he doesn't have anything in the emotional tank. And he's in a desperate need to hear from God. And God shows up, but not in the way that you might expect. It's in the stillness. Now God in Scripture does often show up in loud and bombastic ways. He splits seas. He's in pillars of fire. But it's balanced with God showing up in the quiet. Jesus, God's Son, would go away to quiet, secluded places, the desert, just to be with God. He carved out space on purpose. A funeral is many things. It's a time of celebration for an amazing life lived. It's a time to remember. It's a place to be sad with others. But it's also a place of quietness, where we hope that God shows up, soothes our pain, makes sense of our existence, of time, and more than anything, is with us. And I have to tell you that the good news is that God is very much here this morning. God is in the music, the conversations, in the fellowship hall, in our prayers, and God is in the silence. So this morning, I encourage you not to run from the silence. Some of the hardest silences occur when someone you love is gone. It can be really hard. But the good news is God is in the silence waiting to meet with you. Psalm 46:10 says, "Be still and know that I am God." Silence can be intimidating because the first person you're going to meet when you run into quiet is you. So if you've been consciously or unconsciously on the run from yourself, quiet space is where you can catch up to yourself, your thoughts, your feelings. And God promises to help you consider all of that with Him, to work it out together, to wrestle with God in the safe space of prayer. And sometimes you don't even need words. A reporter once asked Mother Teresa how to pray, how she talks to God. And she replied, "When I pray, often I just listen to God. I give God space in my mind and in my heart." The reporter then asked, I think, a very logical follow-up question. Then what does God say to you? Because if God's going to be speaking to anyone, I think Mother Teresa would be like near the top of my list. But Mother Teresa said, sometimes God just listens to. I found that so profound, that the idea that God would enter into silence with us. As a chaplain at Condell Hospital in Libertyville, I spent time with people that were having the hardest days of their lives. And so often, it wasn't the words from me that they needed. It was just my presence. They just needed to not be alone. And I would spend long hours in the middle of the night in patients' rooms just being there with them. It was one night at 3 a.m. and I was called to the ER. A mother was there with her son, who, let's just say that they weren't having a good night. And she spoke only Polish. I don't know any Polish. But through hand motions, she made it really clear that she did not want to be alone. So we sat together for hours in the middle of the night, in a quiet ER room in Libertyville, and I gave her the only thing that I could, the gift of not being alone. In Romans 8:26, Paul talks about praying without words altogether. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. Through wordless groans, God's Spirit tuning in to our hearts, minds, groaning, resonating prayer for us. It's so comforting. It's so comforting because I think it shows how much God is listening to you. That in the very deepest places of your heart, God is present, listening, aware, in tune with you. Even in the places that we would rather avoid, God is with you. So this morning, as you process the loss of our friend Bill, may you know to the very depth of your being that God is with you. God knows where your heart is. God is understanding, is listening. In the stillness, in the silence, God is present and ready to help you process it all with him. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the beautiful life of Bill, a life expressed through loving Marty and those around him. We celebrate that life and we mourn its passing. God, be with us this morning. Help us celebrate and be sad together. Help us process our loss and wrap us in your presence. Amen. Say the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in God, Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who is conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please kneel as you are able.
Let us pray. Almighty God, in holy baptism, you have knit your chosen people together into one communion of saints in the body of Christ. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace, God of mercy. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to share the new life in Christ. God of mercy, give courage and faith to all who mourn, and a sure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. God of mercy, grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and life. God of mercy, help us in the midst of things we cannot understand to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting. God of mercy, God of all grace, we give you thanks because by his death, our Savior, Jesus Christ, destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection, he opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Say the Lord's Prayer together. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. At this time, I would like to invite up the United States Navy for a presentation of the American flag.
Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Mm-hmm. States Navy and a grateful nation. Please accept this flag as a symbol of our appreciation for your loved one's honorable and faithful service.
Let us commend Bill to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Bill. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. At this time, I'd like to invite up the Boy Scouts of America to present the Order of the Arrow.
We are members of Makajuan Lodge, Order of the Arrow. The Order of the Arrow is a society of members of Boy Scouts of America who have been recognized by the fellow scouts for their outstanding devotion to the Scout Oath. Its foundation is built on brotherhood and cheerful service, modeled after the Delaware Indian. We will now hear a brief history of the required brothers. Over. Thank you.
Wonderful job, boys. Please rise for our blessing. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good, so that you may do God's will, working in you that which is well and pleasing in God's sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Celebrate the wonderful life of Bill Gregory. You are all invited to join us for refreshments down in the fellowship hall. Go in peace. God is with you.